Okay, well, welcome back to Precision Flyer Repairs, part two of repairs getting made to this American Flyer 332 AC 484 Northern steam engine. And since part one, I've reassembled the smoke unit onto the chassis and have wired up the leads to it from the motor, as well as attached to new Superflexy 22 AWG leads that will go to the headlight instead of the old stiff as a board leads that used to be there. It just makes for a better installation of the smoke box cover and less likelihood of these wires wanting to push that smoke box cover out the front of the engine once it's in place. So we've got it also now in the back here, and I'll flip this over in a few minutes, that the wheels and axles of the tender have been addressed and the pickup leaf springs polished as well. So I'm going to get it going here to show you how the motor and the reverse unit and smoke have all turned out. Now, what's interesting in advance is this smoke element measured out at 42.5 ohms. That's dead center of the specification of 35 to 50 ohms. It is, however, a four-wire configured, not five-wire configured engine. And the four-wire configured engines don't deliver as much direct power all the time to the smoke unit headlight as the later five-wire models did. So the smoke production out of this, while within spec, is not a house-on-fire, voluminous kind of smoke production. And what I did then was, with that in mind, spoke to the customer, who I've done other engines for, and some of which have smoked enough to set almost your smoke alarm off in the house, about the fact this is a lighter smoker as it is, but within spec in the original wick and coil functional. I like to get the right expectations and performance results with the customer. After conferring with him, he said, look, you know, I don't need every engine to be a house on fire. In fact, sometimes when I run them, I'd like to know a couple of them won't be quite that much, and use them as lighter smoke generating engines on my layout. So let's keep it the way it is, and know that if I want it to be a heavier smoker in the future, that can be backed down to somewhere around 35 ohms and produce more smoke instead. So when you see this one smoke, it takes a little while to get going, and then it's respectable, but it isn't as instantaneous and a heavy smoker as, for example, the last five-wire Hudson that I finished for him turned out to be. So without any further ado, I thought I'd introduce you to the digital voltmeter here. What I like to do is measure the voltage being delivered at the rail head as a way to see how it's reversing and it's running and it's smoking at different voltage levels. So as you can see right now, there's a little over 12 volts AC delivered to the track, and I'll get the reverse unit going. Voltage at the track drops because now there's a current draw being generated by the engine, its motor, reverse unit solenoid, and smoke unit. You can see the smoke unit now coming to life at about almost 11 volts on the rail head, so that's not too terribly much. You would be running the engine typically above 10 volts at the rail head, maybe up to as many as 14. At 15, it could be dangerous in the curves if it's a quick runner, as this one has turned out to be. As you can see, it's pretty peppy, even just at under 11 volts. And the reverse unit then is working quite dependably. Specification for the reverse unit is 10 volts measured at the rail head. This one we can turn down even more to just under 10 and still get dependable use out of it. In fact, I think we can take it down to virtually 9 volts, and she still fires away with positive connection, dependable action. And the motor is a peppy one. I will turn the speed up. Now we're at almost 12 volts on the rail, and you can see the smoke production is respectable. Again, it's not the 6-alarm type smoke volume that can be made to get generated out of these units, but if you're running at 12 volts out on the layout, this is what you're going to get. And now with a little over 13 volts, you can see she's spinning up to pretty high RPM, generating a respectable amount of smoke. I don't think that would be too terribly disappointing. And again, here we are back to a little over 11, and pretty good. So I think this unit is ready to get final assembly and try it out on the layout. Now, I did mention to you that I polished the wheels and the axles underneath the tender chassis, and I'll show you those in a minute. But I wanted to mention, while I disconnect the tender from the engine, that here at my workbench, I have the ability to test engines that run on AC, DC, DCC, and TMCC or legacy. And every engine gets tested before it's worked on and at certain points along the progress of its repair. And then this stage, of course, where you can put it together and give it a good test with the engine and tender working in concert. The bottom, as you can tell now, is considerably cleaner than it was before. The leaf springs have been polished. The wheel sets have all been removed. The axles polished. The metal wheels polished. And the plastic wheels cleaned. One thing to make note of, in spreading these sintered side frame chassis, you don't want to pull the sides off. You want to push the sides open. So what I use is these spanners in combination with a piece of basswood. I put the basswood in here, or when that middle set is removed, in sideways. And then while that's in place, I tuck the one end of the spanner against the side frame and push the other side against the wood that would be there. I haven't three hands, so it's a little difficult to show you that. And gently push open the side frames. If you pull them, you risk breaking these side frame pieces off or loosening their points of connection at their rivets. And then they're much easier to squeeze shut. You can use flathead pliers and further make perpendicular these side plates when you have the wheel sets back in place instead. But be careful of spreading these and use a push rather than a pull type of approach in doing so. And there we have it. This one, I think, is ready for additional assembly and layout testing. And I'll be back with the third of these videos on this particular engine's progress and final results. Thanks again for joining me for a Precision Flyer Repairs video. To find out more about Precision Flyer Repairs, please visit www.precisionflyerrepairs.com. Thanks again. Until next time, see you then, and have fun running your trends.